The scripture has something to say to all of us, including bear stories. Did anybody find anything unusual in their pew? If you did, do you want to hold it up? And if you didn't already share it, do you want to pass it down? All right. Does everybody have a paper bird in their hand? All right, you don't have to make them fly. You don't have to keep holding them up or waving at me. I just wanted to make sure you noticed them and that you had them. This morning is the first Sunday of Advent, and it is the Sunday of hope. We just heard three scriptures, and the first of these is shared with us from Isaiah. Isaiah is a prophet, and a prophet's job is to point the way. When the prophet lives in a time when everything's going really well, he tends, or she tends, to be the one who critiques the society in which they live and calls the government and the citizens to have equitable relations and ethical connections with each other. But in other times, the prophet is the voice of hope and resilience when things are going terribly wrong. Isaiah is speaking to a people who are exiled from their own land, cut off from their identity, their power base, their farms, their homes, their faith. Isaiah is talking to people who are in desperate need of hope. It's not that far to make the move from Isaiah's time to our time, into our own lives, into the things going on in our nation and our world. Sometimes we're inspired, but sometimes we're very concerned or afraid. The voice of the prophet is speaking not just to the people of his time, but the people of our time as well. A newer prophet, John the Baptist, tells us that Jesus is coming, and he will baptize us in fire and the Spirit, as well as water. Tonight, this morning, fire is our friend. We lit a candle of hope today. And one of the things that John calls us to do is to be not simply a person waiting for hope to show up at our door, but to prepare the way. I thought a lot about hope because it's a word, it's one of those four-letter words that's easy to think you understand until you ask yourself questions about it. For instance, I started interviewing people this week and asking, do you think hope lives inside you? What do you think? Raise your hand if you think hope lives inside you. Do you think hope comes from outside you? Raise your hand if you think hope comes from outside you. Maybe it's a both and. Maybe it's not an either or. Maybe we are beings created for hope. Maybe we are beings that are so profoundly wired to seek connection to something greater than ourselves that we can endure almost anything if we have a purpose, a meaning, a passion, a love. It's easy to say, be hopeful. But it isn't easy when you're Isaiah talking to people cut off from everything. And it isn't easy for us to say it either to the people that most need hope and who are sometimes our greatest teachers about hope. If you want to know about hope, read the words of a Holocaust survivor like Viktor Frankl, who talked about being on a march with other prisoners, and the cold glowing and their skin exposed, and they didn't know what they were marching to, and they were cut off from everyone that they cared about. And the man next to Victor said, "If only our wives could see us now." And what they were hoping was that their wives were not having the same experience that they were having. They knew that if they stopped or stumbled, the guards would turn on them. And Victor found that as he started thinking about his wife, her face came very clear to him. And as he took step after step, he could see her expression, that puzzled, funny expression that was just hers. And he started having a conversation with her in his head, and she answered him in his heart and in his mind. At one point, somebody did fall ahead of them, and then the other people that were marching in front of Victor also fell, and there was a pile of bodies, and the guards started beating them because somebody had fallen. And they picked up the man that needed to be picked up, and they were leaning on each other, and they were walking step by step. And as soon as it was possible, his mind went back to the face of his wife. Viktor Frankl will tell you that humans can endure unbelievable things because there is something else, someone else, to believe in or think about. This isn't news to my family. The cranes that are in your pews are the gifts of volunteers who volunteer for our foundation. Our own daughter, Jessie, lived for 6 years with cancer. And one of the things that she liked to do when she was in a place where she was pushed pretty hard was to give out origami cranes. A friend's daughter made her bags full at a time. Then they all had little ribbons on them, and she would take them and she would pass them out wherever she went in the hospital. And the hospital was like her neighborhood because she lived there for so long and so often. She would give them to the scan technicians and the nurses and the surgeon and the other patients and occasionally the visitors that came through the door. In a time when things are difficult, having the power to offer someone something else is a way of having hope. The patients were also given beads. Based on any treatment, anything that happened to them, it was like a scouting badge or a medal that a soldier might earn. And they would string the beads together and hang them. And every bead was different. And if you wanted to know about a patient, you could ask them to tell you about their string of beads. And the beads were storytelling beads. And Jessie would start wherever she felt like starting. Oh, that gold bead, that's because I lost my hair. And that blue bead is because I got a transfusion. And that sleigh bell is because I was here at Christmas. She got to tell it in whatever order she wanted, and for once in her life, she was a little bit in control. Instead of being poked and prodded on her very body, she was allowed to narrate the story the way it made sense to her, and the way she wanted to share it with others. Throughout history, when people are given the chance to tell their stories and to find their voice, it's a way of being connected with others and having hope. PTSD itself, in fact, is the incapacity to get out of that loop of a story, to break a cycle of memory that is so devastating that you can't live anywhere except in that moment. And it is narrative therapy and retelling a story, changing the ending, or finding a new perspective that gives people a way out of a loop that they can't seem to exit. Who else might you ask about what it's really like to need to live with hope? Caregivers. We were caregivers. There are caregivers throughout this congregation. People who live with the ones that they love. as Isaiah lived with his community. Not able to promise that there was an immediate happy ending to what was happening in a person's life, but that hope is based in memory. Hope is based in knowing who you are and where you come from, and hope is based in the whole of a person's life, or a nation's story, or a world's narrative. Sometimes when we are journeying with the people that we love in the hardest parts of their life, we go day by day and breath by breath. And yet where else would we be except by the side of the one that we love? And we do it not because it's easy now. And we do it not because we're going to necessarily get that magical happy ending that we want. It's because we honor and love the whole of the person, the whole of the community, the whole of the church, the whole of the nation, the whole of the world. A Holocaust survivor said that the Talmud tells us, when you save one life, you save the whole world. We aren't always privileged to save a life, but we can honor a life, our own life, the lives of those we love who are lights in our world, the lights of this community, the hope and the strength and the resilience of this nation, and who we can be to the world. Advent is not sitting in your pew and waiting for somebody to knock on your door. Advent is a verb. Advent is action. It is even the action of bearing witness, or getting up and making a difference, one breath, one moment, one step, one life at a time. John calls us to prepare the way. Advent is anticipation and preparation and waiting, but it is not a quiet, complacent waiting. It is an active, hopeful, resilient being here in this world, in hope of all that this world may become. Today is the first Sunday of Advent, and often churches will do the greeting together. We brought the Christmas tree to you, and today, in order to spread the wings of hope, I invite you to bring the crane that is in your hands and in your pew, and pluck it and tuck it into the Christmas tree. We're going to play a little music. I'm asking you to rise and go to the Christmas tree and put your bird on the tree.
God who is great and no doubt free.